Welcome to Exploration Outer Space. I want to tell you the story of the Gallaudet Group. In the early days of America's space program, several deaf men from Gallaudet College, now Gallaudet University, were selected to go through a series of tests that would ultimately help NASA put a man on the moon. These tests were designed to understand how the body responds to the stresses of spaceflight, which can include motion sickness. Today, we're visiting one of these recruits, David Myers.
Hi. Thank you for having us over.
To help with our interview, we'll be using the assistance of an interpreter.
My name is Mark Seeger, and my role here today is to facilitate communication. I'm a sign language interpreter.
David, do you know why NASA wanted to conduct these tests on zero gravity and motion sickness?
They were very concerned about human ability to survive in space. And as astronauts would be launched into space, they were being exposed to zero gravity for long periods of time. And they didn't want a sick man driving the ship.
The new recruits all had something in common. Their inner ear labyrinth, which is a body part that helps us with our balance, was damaged. This gave them a superpower, immunity to things that make most people nauseous.
We all became deaf, not from birth, but from meningitis, and we had non-functioning inner ears as a result.
This made them perfect subjects for human spaceflight experiments for a couple of reasons. One, they could easily endure extreme tests that allow scientists to learn how spaceflight might affect the body. And two, scientists didn't completely understand what caused motion sickness at the time. Learning why the Gallaudet group was immune could be the key to learning how others, including astronauts, get motion sickness. The tests were led by Captain Ashton Graybill, a noted cardiologist. Many of his tests might have been seen as unusual.
You were one of the few men selected to be in the rotating room experiment. What was that like, and could you feel the room moving around you?
So for 12 days straight, we lived in this room, which constantly rotated at 10 RPM. They were testing how we would react and how that would impact our judgment, how it would impact our balance, and how the body physically responded to that environment. There was another time we went to Nova Scotia, and we boarded on a ship. It went to St. Pierre. It was during the winter time. That area is known to have the roughest seas in North America. We stayed there 3 or 4 days, waiting for the storm to come up. Then we boarded the boat and started our journey back to Nova Scotia. And that was a really rough experience. 40-foot waves, up and down, up and down.
Was this a fun experience, or were you scared at all?
It was very much fun, a very much fun experience. I cannot recall anything that scared me.
From 1961 to 1968, David and his fellow test subjects were run through extensive studies on motion sickness and how it could physically and psychologically impact astronauts during space travel.
How do you feel knowing that you were so integral to the American spaceflight program?
Actually, for a long time, we sort of forgot about it until the Gallaudet decision to move forward with the development of an exhibit.
coming up. A once forgotten part of NASA's space program is remembered.
With that exhibit, we got NASA's attention.
From 1955 to 1968, deaf individuals served as test subjects in a study to better understand motion sickness and how humans can survive and function in outer space. The general public never knew about these efforts until more than 50 years later, when Gallaudet University, where most of the volunteer test subjects once attended, created an exhibition to honor their contributions. This exhibit, called Deaf Difference and Space Survival, is a fascinating display of photographs and printed text, giving any visitor an education about an historical event that was once unknown. This visitor is Harry Larson, who knows firsthand what took place. He was one of the deaf recruits who endured many tests.
Well, looking back, it was a great adventure. Just being involved with that program was thrilling. I was happy to be part of it. It was definitely one of the high watermarks of my life.
One adventure Harry will never forget is that time they traveled 320 kilometers on rough seas in the North Atlantic during the winter. This is Harry posing aboard their vessel.
So this picture behind me was part of a Navy experiment to test whether or not we could get seasick.
Of course, the deaf subjects never do get seasick, further indicating their immunity to motion sickness. Near the end of the trip, Harry remembers how badly frozen everything was on the ship's deck.
At that time, I wasn't thinking much about my safety. But now, looking back, I realize how dangerous the voyage was. And I think to myself, what would have happened if this ship would have sunk?
Because of their ability to endure all types of tests, these men made it possible for scientists to explore human reactions to weightless environments and extreme motion, and learn that the inner ear plays a major role in motion sickness. In this exhibit, we learn all kinds of details, like the fact that during the 50s, the very first deaf test subject was a woman named Pauline Hicks.
So this story has a lot of parallel with the famous Hidden Figure story about African-American women who were involved in the space program. And I think people are starting to learn that minorities have been involved with experiments in history for a long time. And we've always been there, and we're starting to see, we're starting to unveil those stories.
While this group spends nearly a decade as test subjects, astronauts are venturing into space and ultimately reaching the moon. For those 11 men and their families, this exhibit provides an emotional walk down memory lane. And for the public, this exhibit demonstrates how the deaf community has contributed to the space program.
We were different in a way they needed.